jaar tegen onze klanten, tegen onszelf, dat data de backbone van iedere campagne is, dat het er al bij hoort. Of hebben we met ons allen de term big data onszelf aangemeten, omdat we dat interessant vinden klinken. Omdat we als online industrie graag dynamisch willen zijn. En om de 3, 4 jaar een nieuw woordje nodig hebben om met z'n allen achteraan te rennen. En om geld mee te verdienen. Ik vind dat we daar soms een handje van hebben. Wat je daar ook van vindt, zonder goede data of zonder accurate data is goede online marketing eigenlijk niet mogelijk. Maar moet die data komen op uit een ouderwets moodboard? Of uit de mening van jouw mediaplanner met die mooie blauwe ogen? Of moet dat komen uit bereiksonderzoek dat al 20 jaar ongeveer hetzelfde gebeurt? Is dat een manier? Wij denken van niet als DQ&A zijnde, mijn mooie bedrijf. Wij denken dat de wind om moet en dat we datagedreven moeten leren denken. Geen moodboards meer, geen zalvende woorden van mediaplanners of bureaus of mensen die denken het te weten. We moeten data als religie omarmen. Iedere consument krijgt een stickertje op de rug. Het klikgedrag, het kijkgedrag en het conversiegedrag wordt in de gaten gehouden. En iedere consument heeft straks zijn eigen moodboard in de vorm van een eigen persoonlijke advertentie. En daarvoor wordt een prijs betaald die bij de consument hoort. En wie die consument is, dat kiezen we zelf. Wij noemen dat intern altijd right here, right now, right message marketing. En het leuke is ook nog, lieve adverteerder, je kiest die boodschap straks zelf niet meer, het medium, dat doet je klant. Ben je daar klaar voor als organisatie? Ben je bereid om de heilige huisjes die er staan en de meningen van je management te challengen? En is dat management bereid om naar data te luisteren als ze er zelf niets van af weten? Of als ze hun eigen meningen keer op keer niet waar blijken te zijn? Dat zijn allemaal interessante dingen. En ik hoop dat we einde van de avond daar iets meer duidelijkheid in hebben. Flexibel denken is belangrijk. Dat moeten we ook doen als Online Tuesday. Dit zou wel eens onze laatste editie in het mooie Felix Meritus kunnen zijn. Omdat het arme Felix Meritus een financieel zwaar weer verkeert. Omdat we zo succesvol zijn, krijgen jullie wel maar 1 muntje vanavond en geen 2. Dus dat wordt misschien iets vroeger naar huis. Misschien slapen jullie iets beter of juist iets slechter. Dat is omdat we zo succesvol zijn, omdat we naar de grote zaal moeten verplaatsen. Als iemand een goede suggestie heeft, en we hoorden net van Saskia, het mag niet de rode hoed zijn, waar we onze volgende edities kunnen organiseren, dan horen we dat graag. Want we gaan ook nog dingetjes weggeven. We hebben straks, met dank aan de laatste spreker Optimizely, hebben we voor de beste vragen een boekje A/B Testing, The Most Powerful Way to Turn Clicks into Customers. Wie wil dat nou niet? Heel leuk. Wie gaan er vanavond spreken? We hebben 3 mooie sprekers, waarvan 2 internationale. We hebben AppNexus, die gaan zo beginnen. We hebben Massarius als tweede en we hebben Optimizely als derde. En dat zijn allemaal, ik heb ze gezien, mooie verhalen. Dan heb ik nog wat huishoudelijke mededelingen. Als founding partners van Online Tuesday, New People, Traffic for You, Marketing Facts en het altijd gerenommeerde DQ&A. Hebben we een nieuwe partner die we welkom willen heten. Dat is Clockwork. Welkom Clockwork. Maar we hebben nog meer. We hebben ook nog 3 sponsors. En die gaan jullie muntje sponsoren. En de locatie. Dus wees ze zeer dankbaar. Dat zijn AdFactor, Measureworks en Massarius. Bedankt voor het bier. Door naar de eerste spreker. Eerste spreker is Tim Faxon van AppNexus. AppNexus is een van de posterchilds van het Amerikaanse of wereldwijde adtech systeem. Gefund met inmiddels $140 miljoen. En door velen wordt het bedrijf genoemd, het enige bedrijf genoemd, dat eigenlijk kan concurreren met Google op het gebied van display. En Tim met zijn internationale ervaring gaat ons uitleggen hoe die data-driven marketing er dan uitziet, hoe dat in de praktijk werkt en hoe de wereld gaat veranderen. Applaus voor Tim Faxon.
Thanks, Mike. So I'm here from London, so apologies for the English. And I hope that what he said about me was good. I have no idea. So I'm going to talk about data-driven marketing in RTB. So at AppNexus, we focus on RTB, which is it's basically online trading of display. And I'll talk about that at a very high level and then go into some of the uses of data in this type of marketplace. there we go. Data and RTB. So, you know, RTB has basically transformed the way that marketers think about, you know, data. You know, marketers have gone from a sense of long-term planning, multi-year planning, to, you know, the ability or the need to adapt in real time towards events that are happening today. So not only is this type of marketplace, you know, changing the way that marketers think about, you know, collecting users, understanding users, it's also understanding the world events around them and capitalizing on that in real time. So it's a mind shift, and I'll talk about kind of some examples of that. So to start for RTB, and I know this is probably basic for most of you, but to go over kind of some of the mechanics here for some of you, traditional advertising is based on pre-negotiated deals, right? So I want certain thousand impressions at this fixed price on this content. It's all content driven, which is okay, you know, but it's inefficient for some reasons. You know, the biggest one is users, and speaking about user data, you know, if you buy in bulk impressions, you aren't optimizing based upon the price of the user. So the guy sitting on the floor with a cup, I think he's asking for money, on CNN is not quite as valuable as the CEO with the big business card, right? So how do you price differently based on the user that you want to reach? And that's what this marketplace and this technology does. So real-time bidding is the solution. To go over how it works, again, this is probably basic for most of you, but user hits the page. Let's say it's the CEO, hits the page, and then there's a split second when he hits the page that there's an auction that takes place. So before the banner's shown, there is a very quick process in about 100 milliseconds where a bunch of advertisers bid on that user to show him the ad in real time based upon what they know about that user. So if, you know, the winning bid knows that it's a CEO of a company based upon the data they've collected online, they'll bid higher and they'll win that impression and then, you know, move on to the next user that they want to target. So this is far more efficient than a bulk buying process. It's actually valuing what's most important to the marketer, which is the user that's going to buy their products. And the data shows it. I mean, by 2017, there'll be about 20 billion in ad spend in RTB. And you can see the growth numbers here. It's pretty tremendous. So if you guys are thinking about getting into RTB, thinking about how to utilize it, how to utilize data effectively, I would strongly suggest you double down on your efforts. So just a quick word about where we sit and where my perspective's coming from. AppNexus is a technology platform that powers buyers and sellers to connect in real time. So we're a completely customizable technology. We facilitate a marketplace, essentially what we are is a marketplace company, and we're pure technology. So we don't take IOs. So if anyone wanted to hand me an IO after this because of my great presentation, I won't take it. We don't really work with publishers directly. What we do is we facilitate sophisticated trading operations. So, you know, large sales houses, traders, DSPs, we power a lot of these companies. So big data, everybody talks about big data. You know, at AppNexus we see 80 billion ad impressions a day. So there's a lot of data, a lot of information about these users that we need to make sense of. But big doesn't really matter. I'm sure a lot of you in your operations have a lot of data to mine through. What matters is how do you use it? How do you utilize it? How do you capitalize on it? And it's all about finding your audience, right? So in the sea of data, sea of impressions, how do you really get down granularly into the audience that you want to target that's going to buy a product? So to kind of go over some of these methods, you know, out of the box, trading technologies offer a lot of this. So you don't have to kind of boil the ocean and kind of spread your impressions and try to find your users. A lot of these technologies, DSPs, offer, you know, time of day targeting, white lists, black lists of domains, geography, inventory categorization and quality, frequency capping, all of these things. But it's not enough. What I think you should all be thinking about is first and third party data. How do you really utilize what you know about users in conjunction with these things? So I'll break down the different types of data. First party data. This is data that you as a publisher or an advertiser have for yourself. So this could be any login data on a user. This could be a user that's visited your site. My wife likes to shop for shoes, so when I go on her computer, shoe ads follow me around the internet. So that's retargeting, right? These types of things, this is the most valuable piece of data you have, is what do you really know about your audience? How do you know that they interact with your product? How do you know about who they are? I would really consider investing in this and finding out ways to kind of utilize this. DMPs are a great use or can make sense of this for you. I would think about that. Second party data. This is harvested data. So not a term that's used often, but what it means is as you transact online, there's a lot of information about that transaction. User, time of day, whether they clicked, whether they converted. You can collect these users over time into buckets based on what you know about their activity with your ads. And third party data. So these are often kind of marketplaces of data. So, a data provider will collect data from, many publishers and bring it to the market and say, hey, use this when you bid. This is a bit opaque because you don't know where these users are coming from. You just have to take the word of the data provider and saying, yeah, great, you have data that you gave me. The problem, though, is this is commoditized. You could be using this data for bidding while, 50 other people use the same data to try to show the same type of ads. Not very efficient. There's contextual. So this is what we all know. I want to buy some sort of content online because I like associating with this content. There's a lot of providers out there that can actually help you target only above the fold inventory or viewable inventory. There's a lot of scoring providers that can make sure that you're next to the right type of words, not only the top level domain of the site. And the really cool stuff is our environmental data. We're seeing this with a lot of our traders. I'll give you an example, the weather. Our traders can take in a stream of weather data and only target their convertible ads to places where it's sunny, right? No one's gonna buy a convertible where it's raining. So no one would buy a convertible here right now. The market, so no one's gonna spend big purchases if their portfolio is down, right? So these things all factor together in terms of whether someone's actually gonna buy an ad. So I hear there's a lot of marketers in the room today, so I'll kind of go over some recommendations and tactics, things to think about. It seems like a lot of information. There's a lot of ways to cut users. So number one is consolidation is ideal. If you're using, if you're splitting your budgets across multiple providers, these providers don't really talk to each other, right? So a common example is frequency capping. So if you want to reach a user 3 times a day, but you're spreading your budget around 20 sources, those sources aren't talking to each other. You could be showing a user an ad 60 times a day. Optimization follows the same rule set, right? So if one system's optimizing towards something, another is doing the same, those systems aren't talking to each other. So I'd say find a provider that can actually house a lot of this kind of sophistication for you in a consolidated way. Second is customization. So I talked about second party data and how you can harvest data, collect it, model it. There's a lot of providers out there that are actually taking all these types of data and the variables with them and stringing them together to create a profile of user. So not only can they just target specifically about kind of what they're doing, just a retargeter or something like that, a lot of these providers can actually string together all these different types of data and provide a valuable kind of insight into your user. That goes to my next point is make sure you're learning about your users during the process. Will a vendor actually help you learn about your audience as opposed to just spending your money? Fourth, can they actually model users across multiple channels? So how does search impact display? How does display impact social? If you can get a holistic picture of your users, it's incredibly valuable. And there's some companies out there today that can help kind of find the right weighting between these sources, which has been really powerful. And lastly, can they influence the whole purchase funnel? Can they drive brand awareness all the way to conversion? So these are just some things to think about. And I'll open it up for questions. I do have some case studies, but I want to jump to questions. Great, let's do it. All right, so if you guys do think of questions, here's my email, tfaxon@appnexus.com. Very high-level presentation. If you have specifics, just shoot them to me. Happy to talk about it. So I'll give you an example of one of our traders that are doing some really interesting things, MediaIQ. Essentially what they do is they are in the business of partnering with advertisers to not only find the right user combinations for their performance, but also provide insights back about their end audience. And I'll give you an example of that. So, you know, what you would assume to target for hotels may not be the actual, you know, user that a hotel thinks is their user. So, for example, through MediaIQ's audience platform, they think that what it ends up being is reaching Liverpool at 7 p.m. on a Sunday is the best combination for this advertiser, right? Who would have known? But RTB and, you know, taking some of these variables together actually allows you to spit out the right type of an insight about a user. Another quick example is one of our clients, I'm calling them Client A. They do media syncing. So essentially, for an advertiser like Mercedes, they know when a Mercedes ad is showing based upon a feed that they get into our platform, and they show relevant pre-roll ads and banner ads at the same time that those commercials are showing, right? So this goes to the environmental data that I was talking about and taking into account not only like location, but also kind of when an ad is showing and showing it across multiple screens. So those are two quick case studies. Thank you.
Rondje vragen doen of weten we het allemaal wel? Geen vragen? Daar is één vraag. Loop jij daarheen? Yeah. We have a question.
Yeah. Hey. So the second case study, you showed a sort of Mercedes sort of syncing with this offline commercials. Sounds really great, of course. but does it also help? You see like an increase in performance?
Yes. I don't have actual stats on how that performed, but my email address is right there. So if you want to ping me or find me after, I can actually get you general data about how that's performed.
Want je hebt daar zelf al ervaring mee op die manier? Of?
Nou ja, dit is wel een redelijk kritisch publiek, dus een soort van RTB voor dummies. Het zou leuk zijn om iets meer info te krijgen, zeg maar.
Maar je kan dan niet een gerichtere vraag...
Nou, dat was een redelijk gerichte vraag, toch?
Thanks, Tim.
Sure.
Voor mij.
Ja, ik vond het een goede vraag, hoor. Ik vond hem heel goed. Maar het antwoord is moeilijk te geven natuurlijk. Het hangt niet alleen af van de techniek. Het hangt van je campagne af, van je boodschap, van je doelgroep. Het is een moeilijk antwoord. Laten we doorgaan naar de volgende spreker. Bert-Jan ten Kaat van Massarius. Ik moet expliciet vertellen dat hij hier niet staat omdat we sponsor zijn. Maar omdat het iemand is die heel veel weet van vooral het Nederlandse online ecosysteem. Massarius helpt uitgevers bij het verhandelen van hun inventory. die ze al dan niet direct verkocht hebben. En Massarius is eigenlijk de essentiële tussenschakel tussen techniek, uitgevers en adverteerders. En wat Bert-Jan gaat doen, is ons meenemen in de wereld van het Nederlandse R2B-landschap. Hoe dat werkt, waar je op moet letten, wie de spelers zijn en wat je allemaal kunt doen. Geniet ervan.
Inderdaad, een volle zaal als je zo kijkt. Meestal zit ik te kijken. Ik geniet dat heel graag. Over die vraag over dat synken. Media Sync heeft hier al een paar keer gestaan om dat te vertellen. Die kan je ook direct benaderen. Ikzelf ben dus Bert-Jan Tekaten van Massarius. En ik ben gevraagd om een introductie te geven in het Nederlandse ecosysteem voor automated trading. En met specifiek perspectief van de publisher. Dat kan ik doen. Ik heb een aantal jaren bij publishers gewerkt. 5 jaar bij Marktplaats, ook nog bij Hives. Ja, dat heeft ook bestaan. Nog TMG wat geholpen. En toen zag ik dat middelgrote uitgevers niet in staat waren om in te tappen op de budgetten van automated trading. Er komt behoorlijk veel techniek bij kijken. En ik dacht van, daar gaan we ze helpen. Inmiddels werken we voor de 30 publishers. En zien we dat het medialandschap heel hard groeit in het automated trading deel. Deze kennen jullie natuurlijk. Dit is het landschap. Er zijn 4 grote SSP's in Nederland actief. Dat is AppNexus. AppNexus is SSP en DSP. Wie begrijpt het als ik de term SSP en DSP gebruik? Dan weet ik even hoe Seffi dit publiek is. Ietsje hoger die handen, want ik zie het niet helemaal. Oké, dat is ongeveer 65%. Even belangrijk om te weten. SSP's, dat zijn veilingssystemen. En DSP's zijn biedingssystemen. En het was inderdaad misschien voor sommige mensen R2B voor dummies. Maar we gaan ook zo meteen even de diepte in. Kijken of je dan erbij bent. Dus opletten. AppNexus is dus een hele grote, Google is een hele grote, er zijn een paar andere partijen, zijn Rubicon en Improved Digital. Dat zijn dus voor publishers de systemen om al die biedingen en al die data en al die systemen op te vangen. We zitten dan ook daar, zeg maar, met al die partijen. We zijn ook meer een yield manager dan een sales house, we staan er wel bij. Yield management betekent site optimaliseren, zorgen dat de systemen goed hebt, nieuwe ontwikkelingen, nieuwe partijen die er komen. En dan werken we dus heel veel met al die technische partijen die allemaal ontwikkelingen doorgaan. Dus het synken met zo'n Mercedes reclame, ja, moet je even kijken of dat wel goed gaat. Massarius betekent trouwens rentmeester in Latijn. Rentmeester is een hedendaags mooi Nederlands woord voor yield manager. En automated trading gaat hard. Dit is het onderzoek van IAB Nederland, uitgevoerd door Deloitte. En 2012 zeiden ze van 29% van het budget is automated. Eerste helft 43%. Sommige mensen vinden dat veel, maar het zou best wel zo meteen waar kunnen zijn. 2013, ik denk dat het voor de tweede helft, er zijn de cijfers nog niet van bekend. Maar er zijn 3 sales houses die ook overgegaan zijn op automated trading. Saleshouses die dus display op een traditionele IO manier aan verkopen waren. 3 saleshouses zijn Adfab, Ad7 en IM Networks. En leuk is dat AppNexus daar hun systeem heeft neergezet. Maar daar kom ik zo meteen nog even op terug. En ook de persgroep is ook begonnen met een titel om daar automated in te gaan. Dat betekent dat er veel meer advertentieruimte beschikbaar wordt voor automated trading. Andere kant op is dat er veel meer rich media komt. En rich media betekent hoge CPM's. En daardoor gaan die budgetten ook harder omhoog dan dat het aandeel in volume gaat groeien. En los daarvan hebben we ook nog mobiel en video. Het is eigenlijk een trend die al langer plaatsvindt. In 2008 maakte ik plaatjes over de onderstroom van Always On. Je moet altijd met search moet je ergens staan. Daarbovenop heb je allemaal campagnes. Tegenwoordig heeft iedereen Facebookpagina's, heeft iedereen een native sponsoring. Nou, niet iedereen dan. Maar daarbij is gekomen dus high impact advertising. En dat wordt ook continu ingezet. Dus als er een trigger afgaat van, hey, daar is een dame zwanger. Van op dat moment gaat zij billboards ontvangen met mooie dingen over babyspullen. En het is niet zo dat het hele jaar door dus die campagne loopt, maar trigger-based. Bij ons, zeg maar, 6 maanden geleden hadden we nog geen billboards. Nog niet automated. Nu doet 15% van die bovenste positie doen billboards. AppNexus is zeg maar, sinds een maand volgens mij dat ze ook billboards kunnen serveren op Rubicon. Dus al die connecties moeten gemaakt worden. Maar als het eenmaal staat, gaat het heel hard. Het automated ecosysteem, daar ga ik zo meteen wat in breed over vertellen. En dan gaan we even de diepte in. Goed opletten. Er zijn 3 manieren hoe er wordt ingekocht. Real-time bidding, tag-based. En CPC-deals en affiliate deals, die draaien daar ook in mee. En wat een SSP doet, zo'n veilingssysteem, het is eigenlijk wat meer dan een veilingssysteem, die kijkt naar performance-campagnes. Die worden op CPC ingekocht bijvoorbeeld. CTR gaat naar beneden. Dat betekent dat gemiddeld CPM naar beneden komt. En dan kan je beter een ander systeem daar draaien. Sommige systemen bieden meer of minder, sommige een vaste prijs. En met RTB ga je daar nog eens een keer overheen kunnen bieden. En eigenlijk wat je doet is op elke moment kijken welke impressie het meest oplevert. En dat is yield management. En wat we net zagen was alleen RTB. Maar tag-based betekent bijvoorbeeld dat een Zalando continu advertenties rouleert. Of dat er een advertentienetwerk continu advertenties inserveert. Maar dat is niet met real-time bidding erbij. Dan neem je gemiddelde prijzen. Nog iets over real-time bidding. Dat ook daar krijg je verdieping en verbreding. Je hebt allemaal mooie woorden als private marketplaces, als programmatic premium. Dat zijn allemaal buzzwords. Wat er gebeurt is eigenlijk dat er op een higher level weer wordt ingekocht. Dus dat bijvoorbeeld, wij werken ook voor Reformatorisch Dagblad. Daar gaat niet om dat het de laagste prijs is, maar dat er geautomatiseerd ingekocht kan worden. Net zoals het voorbeeld dat de Timothy gaf, is dat je die billboard maar 5 keer laat zien in heel Nederland. Dus niet zeg maar 5 keer op Marktplaats of 5 keer op nu.nl, maar 5 keer, maakt niet uit waar die persoon zich aandient. Als je verder kijkt dus naar RTB, hoe er wordt ingekocht, zijn er 2 manieren, of eigenlijk hoe dat wordt aangeboden aan adverteerders. Dat is de eerste. Dan zegt die adverteerder, ik heb 1,50 euro CPM nodig, krijgt hij geadviseerd van iemand. Dat is een trading desk. En die gaat met dat bot in een DSP. Een DSP, dat is dus de bieder. En die gaat dan in een veiling. En in die veiling wordt dan het hoogste bot gekozen om daarmee die impressie aan die adverteerder te geven. Retargeting partijen, die combineren zo'n trading desk met zo'n DSP. Dat is een yield division, misschien ook wel eens van gehoord. Dat is 1 partij of Criteo. Die hebben technologie en het managen ervan in 1 systeem zitten. DQNA gebruikt dubbelklik bidmanager om mee te bieden. Een andere manier van inkopen zijn bureaus. En ik heb even de langste keten genomen die er nu in Nederland is. Dat is een adverteerder gaat naar een bureau. Een bureau die vraagt een management fee daarvoor. Ik heb even aangenomen dat alle partijen in deze markt allemaal 15% management fee vragen. En dat kan zijn dat het een vast campagnebedrag is. Het kan zijn dat het 30% is, dat het 10% is. Maar om zeg maar geen helemaal inzicht te geven hoe er wordt ingekocht, heb ik gemiddelde genomen van 15%. Links adverteerder die biedt. Het zijn allemaal partijen die advertentie doorgaan verdelen en dan in principe waarde toevoegen in de keten. En dan komt er een bod uit dat bij de veiling terechtkomt. En dat krijgt dan de publisher. Hij krijgt wel heel veel campagnes, dus hij kan heel veel verkopen. Maar je ziet dat er heel veel waarde wordt toegevoegd in de keten tussen die eerste impressie en degene waarvoor die naar de publisher gaat. Ja, sorry, was misschien iets te diep. Dat Zullen we even pauze doen? Ik ga nog even een klein stapje verder. Want je hebt ook namelijk dat er arbitrage wordt gedaan. Arbitrage betekent, ik verkoop iets. En dan ga ik kijken of ik het voor een lagere prijs kan inkopen ergens anders. En arbitrage, dus een adverteerder krijgt een aanbieding voor 1,50 CPM in te kopen. Nou, maar als je biedt in een veiling, dan komt er, dan is het je hoogste bod. Maar je betaalt niet het hoogste bod, je betaalt het bod dat eronder ligt. En dat kan dus lager liggen. En nu is de vraag dus of die inkoper dat voordeel wat daar zit teruggeeft aan de adverteerder. Of dus het arbitrage is en dat hij daarmee zijn geld verdient. En dan heb je nog dat er kickbacks en surcommissions zijn van publishers dat teruggaat naar bureaus. Daarom zijn er nieuwe trends aan het ontstaan. Dat dus bijvoorbeeld Zalando zelf met DoubleClick Bid Manager gaat bieden op inventory van publishers. Die zijn zo groot dat ze dit zelf naar zich toe trekken. Het is niet zo heel gek, dat gebeurde met AdWords 7 jaar geleden ook. Grote partijen gingen zelf aan de knoppen zitten om keywords in te kopen. Dikinees assisteert Telfort bijvoorbeeld met het inkopen. En zo zijn er KLM, die wordt geassisteerd door StormMC, dat ze zelf zeg maar direct aan het bieden zijn. We noemen dit een client trading desk. Dit gaat heel hard komend jaar. Om nog even wat veranderingen door te geven in de markt. Zeg maar, is dit ook een mooi plaatje om te laten zien wat er gebeurt. Een click district, zo heette het voorheen, was een trading desk en een DSP tegelijkertijd. Hadden ze zelf gebouwd en nu zijn ze platform 161 en 161 Media. Het zijn twee verschillende bedrijven omdat zij met hun technologie eigenlijk naar adverteerders gaan en zeggen, gebruik het zelf maar. De integratie is eigenlijk die hier gebeurt bij GroupM. Dat GroupM die heeft als onderdeel Xaxis. Die laat de trading doen door Banner Connect, of eigenlijk de manager daarvan. En die gebruikt AppNexus en AppNexus doet de bieding en komt bij de publisher terecht. En GroupM heeft AppNexus gekocht vorige week. Dat was misschien. GroupM. That would be news, right? That would be news. GroupM heeft Banner Connect gekocht. Dit is natuurlijk heel interessant, want zeg maar, daarmee komt er meer controle in de keten. En, en wordt het ook dus een grotere speler om met AppNexus te spreken, bijvoorbeeld. Dan hebben we publishers, die hebben ook nog dus AppNexus of zeg maar, andere SSP-systemen. En dat betekent dat je dus verder de keten in kan. Meer controle geeft je meer mogelijkheden om te optimaliseren. Maar geeft nu nog heel veel andere mogelijkheden ook. De vraag is nog, zeg maar, wat er gaat gebeuren met partijen die nu door Banner Connect geserviced worden. Gaan die ook nog steeds bij Banner Connect blijven? Vind ik een interessante vraag. En het andere is dat sommige publishers die net dus AppNexus hebben geïnstalleerd, die drie saleshouses waar we net over hadden, dat is geïnstalleerd door Banner Connect. Dus de vraag is, gaan andere partijen die inkopen, gaan die blijven bieden op die partijen waar AppNexus is geïnstalleerd? Want in principe ja, is het eigenlijk GroupM die kan meekijken in hoe de andere biedingen verlopen. En je wil niet altijd aangeven welke biedingen door wie voor welke prijs worden gegeven voor welke adverteerder. In principe, Banner Connect is een hele strikte partij, dus echt een hele goede. Maar we weten allemaal, als een bedrijf wordt overgenomen, na 18 maanden komt toch op een gegeven moment zeg maar, iemand er om de hoek kijken, om ze te kijken hoe het gaat. Heel interessant. Dit is het plaatje dus hoe het eruit ziet. Ik heb zelf even gekeken hoe de CPM verloop was afgelopen jaar bij ons. Ik heb wat stabiele titels genomen. Alle rich media, mobiele cijfers eruit gehaald. En gekeken van ja, wat gebeurt nou in het ecosysteem door externe factoren. We hebben hier per maand in de rood dus de prijs en in blauw het volume. We zijn inmiddels nu 3-4 keer groter, maar je hebt sowieso seasonality. Ja? Dus de eerste paar maanden van het jaar is het rustig. Maar er gebeurden twee dingen vorig jaar. 1. Een hele grote publisher in Nederland, die reduceerde het aantal advertentieposities van 12 naar 5. waardoor zeg maar, de hoeveelheid advertentieruimte waarop ingekocht kan worden, verkleinde. Dat betekent dat de CPM omhoog ging. Het tweede is dat je had de cookie-wetgeving. Cookie-wetgeving die werd op een gegeven moment versoepeld. Bedrijven als Unilever hadden 2 maanden al hun online budgetten stilgezet. Maar ook partijen die met retargeting werkten als Criteo, die zeiden van even wachten. We gaan niet kijken of we zo meteen met ons hoofd op het hakblok gaan. En die gingen allemaal weer retargeting en dat soort zaken inkopen. Ondertussen ging de CPM omhoog en zie je dat alle affiliate partijen gewoon heel erg moeilijk hebben om te blijven bestaan. Omdat al die rest inventory waar ze vroeger op zaten, wordt nu ingevuld door RGB en door andere systemen. En wat je zag in de laatste maand van het kwartaal, bidding squeeze. En dat betekent dat iedereen moet zijn budgetten kwijt en iedereen is aan het bieden. En dat betekent dat de prijs dan omhoog schiet. Dat zullen we komend jaar nog wel vaker gaan zien. Dus ik zie voor publishers zie ik goede tijden in 2014. Ondertussen zijn er ook wat nieuwe partijen in de markt gekomen. De partijen die eigenlijk traditioneel niks van automated trading wilden weten, omdat ze op zich nog wel goed gingen. De business-to-business partijen. Er zijn ook 2 van die sales houses die ik net noemde, die doen business-to-business. We zijn onlangs gestart voor BNR van FD. Reformatorisch Dagblad zou je ook niet snel verwachten om in automated te gaan. Er kunnen toch allemaal gekke advertenties langskomen. Daar zijn we ook voor gestart. Maar dat heeft een hele andere aanpak. Daar ga je eigenlijk zorgen dat de prijs hoog is en verkoop je niet zeg maar, de hele ruimte. Er zullen meer business-to-business partijen de markt in zien komen. Niet omdat het goedkoper is, maar omdat het eenvoudiger is om in te kopen voor die inkopende partijen. Nog even over yield management, vanuit publisher gezien. Eigenlijk wat er gebeurt is, je hebt een bepaalde hoeveelheid advertentie-impressies en je hebt de prijs. En wat je gaat... Oh, wacht even, dat is mijn volgende slide. Eentje te snel. Je moet beginnen om eerst even te kijken, wat voor veilingssysteem ga ik gebruiken? Er zijn dus 4. Als je een kleine titel bent, dan kan je beter met een paar advertentienetwerken werken. Als je heel groot bent, moet je dit zelf doen. Dit is echt iets, dat moet je in-house hebben, omdat dit heeft te maken met hoe je site performt. Het heeft met zoveel dingen te maken, dat dit moet je niet uitbesteden. En als je ergens tussen de 3 en 50 miljoen zit, dan zijn er allemaal manieren om het wel door iemand anders te laten doen. En je kan het zelf doen, maar dan moet je het leuk vinden. Je hebt veel analysecapaciteit nodig. Je moet begrijpen hoe technisch trafficking werkt. Je moet ook goed nadenken over propositiemanagement. Er zijn genoeg partijen. Sanoma werkt voor een aantal publishers in Nederland. Wij werken voor publishers in Nederland. Maar het team van Sanoma zit hier, zit 12 man. En die zitten elke dag te rekenen om te zorgen dat de yield zo hoog mogelijk is. Er zijn wat saleshouses die vanuit de IO-wereld komen. Die zijn bezig om het wat slimmer aan te pakken. Dat komt beetje bij beetje. En wat we doen is eigenlijk dus een curve. Prijs maal volume levert de omzet. En daar werk je op, eigenlijk op die curve. En dat gebeurt door het jaar heen, door de dag heen. Als er een weersite is met heel veel bliksem op zo'n dag. Dat betekent dat de bak met inventory heel groot is. En ren je heel snel door alle budgetten heen die er zijn. Dus dan kan je misschien gedurende de dag de CPM, de minimumprijs verlagen. Waardoor toch nog weer wordt ingekocht. En wat we doen, we proberen die curve hoger te maken door meer biedende partijen in de markt te krijgen. Of dus meer data toe te voegen. Wij geven dus mee of het above the fold of below the fold is. Wat voor categorieën het zijn, zodat er specifieker op wordt ingekocht. Dit doen, zeg maar, alle grote publishers, die doen dit soort dingen. En dan werken we ook met de inkopende partijen. Wat zijn hun win rates? Dus als een bid geeft, welk deel wordt er daadwerkelijk gewonnen? Wat is de laagste prijs? En ze hebben allemaal verschillende strategieën. De een begint hoog en weet precies wat ze willen gaan kijken hoe laag de prijs kan zijn. Andere partijen beginnen heel laag en kijken wat ze daarvoor kunnen krijgen. Er zitten hele verschillende manieren voor inkoop. En dan kan je ze helpen om beter te performen. Dit was in Vogelvlug hoe yield management werkt. En was mij ook nog gevraagd om te kijken, wat gaat er nog gebeuren? Nou, zoals ik al zei, veel integratie en consolidatie bij DSP's, trading desks en search engine marketing bureaus. Een van de grote dingen die nu zijn, is dat je search met display kan combineren. Dus je zoekt mensen die bepaalde keywords intikken, geef je bepaalde display. Dat betekent dat SEMs gecombineerd gaan worden met kopende partijen, of met DSP's. Andere is offline en online. Ook dat groeit naar elkaar toe. Dus partijen die alleen online aan het werk waren en heel goed erin zijn, worden gekocht door grotere partijen die ook offline en search aan het doen zijn. Heel veel kleine SEM-bureautjes komen eraan. En dat is hetzelfde wat 7 jaar geleden gebeurde. Toen was er eerst Checkit en Traffic for You. Een jaar later waren er 150 AdWords-bureautjes die hielpen met keywords in te kopen. Dat gebeurt ook met display zometeen. SEMs gaan ook display doen en kleine bureautjes gaan ook zelf kunnen bieden. En radio en televisie. Kijk, Pats, hupstee, 2014. Oh, vragen. Ja, zijn er vragen?
Dat, ja.
Zag ik iets voor? Oh, sorry.
Vragen?
Was het helder?
Sorry,
dat is
een
eigen vraag die ik aan jullie heb. Was het helder wat hier verteld werd? Handen omhoog als het helder was. Oké, gelukkig.
Ik heb wel een vraag, Bart-Jan. Wat heb ik er als klant aan dat Groep M Xaxis heeft en Banner Connect?
Banner Connect weet ontzettend veel van hoe ze moeten inkopen. Dus dat is echt voor Groep M is dit een gouden zet. De waarde die toegevoegd wordt in een keten, daar heb ik een grotere vraag bij. Maar dan is ook de vraag zeg maar, of een Xaxis en een Banner Connect wel zeg maar, of dat samen gaat of dat het los van elkaar staat. Maar het is niet helemaal aan mij om daar...
ik ben benieuwd naar je mening. Is het zeer strategisch of is het een manier om drie keer marge te pakken?
Zeer strategisch.
Of is het strategisch drie keer marge pakken?
Zeer strategisch. Ja.
Vraag uit de zaal?
Ik zag een hele mooie spreadsheet. Waar is je ROI?
ROI... Dat is zo 2013, man. Het gaat om bereik, het gaat om online.
Nee, de winrate is niet belangrijk. Ik wil geld verdienen.
Sorry, wat zeg je?
Ik wil geld verdienen.
Ja, maar wie ben je? Ben je een publisher? Ben je een adverteerder? Ben je een bureau in het midden?
Booking.
Booking.com.
Ja.
Kijk, nou ken ik toevallig...
Wij verdienen best wel wat geld.
Ja. Ja, nee, dat klopt. Ja, kijk, jullie werken met Criteo. Maar jullie zijn volgens mij zelf gaan kijken hoe je ook met biedingen aan de gang kan gaan. Ik ben een buurjongen van iemand die... ga ik zo meteen met de bar over jou aan praten. Jij kan echt heel veel geld verdienen. Jij kan echt heel veel geld, zeg maar, zelf gaan... ook omdat jullie hele goede developers hebben. Dus je kan, als je zo'n AppNexus-platform bouwt... kan je er gewoon dingen bovenop bouwen... die tailored zijn voor jullie business. Daar gaat het heen. Zeg maar, ja. Zeg maar, dat een Zalando of KLM met DoubleClick Bitmanager aan de slag gaan, dat is stap 1. Omdat alles staat er. Maar stap 2 is integratie. Dat je al je hotels en publiek en follow-up en dat je e-mail stuurt. En iedereen die niet die e-mail heeft gelezen, die ga je alsnog zeg maar retargeten. Om toch nog te kijken of je die message bij die bezoeker kwijt kan gaan. Dus dan kan je heel slim... Met je budget spend omgaan. Dat is typisch iets wat een bureau niet zou doen, omdat hij niet met e-mail marketing aan de slag gaat. Snap je?
Ja. Heb ik nog een follow-up vraag? Je ligt daar een mooi boek van AB-testen. AB-testen doe je meestal, maak je 2 varianten en dan meet je succes. En dan vergelijk je succes van de ene variant met de andere variant.
Ja.
Nou hebben we hier een hele lange keten van allerlei spelers die meedoen in dit proces. Ik ga bieden in real time op dingen, dus dat kan ook nog eens in de tijd veranderen. Hoe meet ik of dit, het hele proces, beter werkt dan wat ik hiervoor deed? Hoe zie ik het verschil?
Zeg maar, het hele proces is afhankelijk van hoeveel je er zelf doet. Dus AB-testen wordt ontzettend veel gedaan, zeker hierin. En dat is namelijk heel makkelijk, want je kan... aparte audiences maken en daar laat je random advertenties aan zien en dan audiences waarmee je dus specifieke uitingen toont. Maar ik denk dat dit een mooie vraag is voor Optimizely, want die zijn hier, wij hebben heel veel gedaan, maar Optimizely weet hier ontzettend veel van hoe je dat moet doen. Echt, maar het gebeurt echt heel veel.
Ik zie een retargeting aan de bar zo. Iemand anders nog vragen? Nee? we nu even gaan wisselen van laptop volgens mij voor de presentatie van Matt? You want to do it from your laptop, ja? Yeah? Oké. Zo, één momentje.
Ah, should we try it?
Yeah. I think it's gonna work then.
Bet. Oh, good.
Let me try
it, all right? Oh, whenever you're ready. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Okay, we gaan weer beginnen. We zijn nu even klaar met R2B. Ik zag jullie klagen, maar het is een belangrijk verhaal om te vertellen. We gaan verder met wat er op de site gebeurt. Matt Elthauser is van Optimizely. En Optimizely is de expert op het gebied van AB-testing, multivariate testing. En hele slimme dingen doen met de bezoeker op je site om iedere procent conversie uplift eruit te peuren. Dus watch and learn.
Okay. Can everyone hear me? Is that good? Okay, perfect. Hey, so I'm going to do this in English. I've lived in Amsterdam for a year, but my Dutch is still pretty shitty, so I apologize. And I know this is a rough crowd. We tried to buy beers for everyone, but they wouldn't let us, and apparently that's why this place is going bankrupt. But hopefully, we can get you guys something to drink after this, and everyone will calm down, and we'll be in a good way together. So. I'm Matt. I'm the GM of Optimizely here in Europe. I joined the company when we just had 7 people and 6 developers in one room and it smelled really bad. But we've come a long way and now we're here in Amsterdam, the greatest city in Europe. Don't tell my wife, she's German, I said that. But it's fine, so here we go. So, we're doing a live A-B test right now. If you tweet either one of these, we'll give you guys a free ticket to our roadshow that we're actually hosting in Amsterdam. We're at the Roken offices. We just moved in on Monday in the NRC building. But if you tweet either one of these, you can get a free ticket. The first 50 to do so will get that free ticket, and Jerry will be following up with you. All right. So here's a few of our clients. We have about 6,000 of them. We've been in business since 2010. Both of our founders are ex-Google product managers, Dan and Pete. Dan actually was the director of analytics for the Obama campaign, 2007-2008. And it was really his work there that led to Optimizely's development. We're going to go through some live case studies today, talk about all of that. Hopefully you guys will be ready to raise your hands, and you've put your deodorant on, so we'll get some good crowd interaction. All right, so everyone know what this is? What's it in Dutch? Nelpard. Okay, well, it's a hippo in English. And the whole reason why we're here today is to talk about data and how it should drive decisions inside of an organization. I think the gentleman here is from Booking.com. They're really a great example of companies that do this. And we really love talking to and working with other companies to do that. So what I want to do today is arm you guys with some ideas and actual steps that you can use in your organization to fight this. And the first thing that you have to do is you have to believe in this man right here. And at Optimizely, this guy's named Data, and he is king. Actually, not him. It's like, you know, not the person, but the actual data is the king. But he represents a lot of things for us. And so hopefully you guys can take these best practices back to your company or companies or organizations or whatever they are and deploy those to make better decisions. So the first step in any data-driven organization or in anything, we believe, is to define success. And success means a lot of things to different people. So for Booking.com, it means booking hotels. Lots of those. Cash money. He's showing me right there. For you guys here tonight, it means how many beers can we consume at the bar. And for our client, actually, it meant becoming the president of the United States. And that's a very binary goal. You either are or you aren't. But the process to getting there is not binary at all. There's a lot of different things that you can measure. So what you have to do is not just define success, but you have to also define quantifiable success metrics along the way. And so when the campaign actually sought out, you know, to put this person in the White House, Barack Obama, they started thinking about what are the things that we can measure and what are things that we can do differently. And what they really started to focus on was a grassroots campaign that used a lot of data. And a lot of data and a lot of different nodes of people donating money. And so they started looking at the internet. Okay? So Dan, our CEO, he was actually director of analytics back then. He came online and they started looking at everything and they started looking really easily at, okay, how many visitors do we have? What's the sign-up rate of people that come to our landing page? And ultimately, what's the amount of money that people give? And when they started looking at this, what they realized was that they had amazing traffic. How many people here remember the 2007-2008 elections? If not, you were probably under a rock. It was pretty big around the whole world. But at any rate, they had lots of traffic, so that wasn't a problem. They had actually a really, really high amount of people donating money when they had signed up. But what they didn't have was a lot of people just signing up. So what they saw was an opportunity to improve, and this was a quantifiable success metric. What they realized was that if they could drive more signups on their landing pages, then ultimately they could drive their end goal of getting more people to donate money. Hopefully. So they set out and they created what's called a multivariate test. How many people know what that is? Yeah? Okay, well, we're going to go through one live today so everyone can interact and learn. Okay, so this is a multivariate test right here. It's the most simple form. What we have up above is an image or media, okay? And down below, we have a button. And a multivariate test really simply is just changing around different objects on a page randomly to see which combination of those works most effectively among your traffic. Okay? So they set up this test. And here's the different media and the different buttons that they had. Okay, so on the left-hand side, you see all of these. And we'll go through all of them together. And what I need you all to do is, after we go through all of them, we're going to have you guys vote. Okay? So here's the sign-up button. Learn more. Join us now. And sign up now. Okay? Now that's the buttons, it's a multivariate test, so you're going to vote for one button and one media, okay? So, now we're going to go through the media, okay? So, we had the get involved image, okay? The family image, the change image, and some videos. Okay. And that was Barack's video. And the last video, Sam's video.
There are those who are preparing to divide us. The spin masters, the negative ad peddlers, who embrace the politics of anything goes. Well, I say to them tonight, there is not a liberal America and a conservative America. There is the United States of America.
I'm going voting. I'll see you all later. Not really. So, okay, so this was all of the media choices. So now what we're going to do is have everyone vote. Okay, so the first thing we're going to go through is all of the buttons. Okay, so you can only vote one for one button and one for one media. Okay, so how many people thought it was sign up? Minority. Learn more? Okay, a few people. Join us now. Majority. And sign up now, just for giggles, a few people. Okay. And how many people, now we're going through the media, okay? So how many people thought it was a get involved image? Zero. I've never seen that. Family image? Few folks. Change image? A little more. Barack's video? Few. Springfield video? Okay, and Sam's video? Yes. All right, so it looks like we had a clear winner of Join Us Now and Sam's video. Well, we'll see. So we have one winner, we think. So what turned out is actually Learn More. Okay. And also quite surprising was the family image. I always get this response in Europe. It's like Europeans are disgusted with the family image. It's amazing. Okay. Mid-America is a very big place, everyone. It's a very big place. Okay. So now let's go ahead and actually take a look at the results. Okay. So these are the actual results. Now the campaign, this was 2007, 2008, before beautiful things like Optimizely existed. So they used, they actually used Google Website Optimizer, which is a free tool. Now it's called Content Experiments. If you know, if you want to do something for free, you can absolutely go and grab that tool off the shelf. But at any rate, they ran this test, and what you'll see is actually pretty interesting in these results. So up above, the top four are the buttons, and the bottom are the different videos and the media, right? What you see that's really interesting is that the original, which is Learn More, outperformed all of them by 18%. But what's really interesting is down here is that every single video did worse than every single image. Anyone have ideas as to why that is? Wait, what? Takes too long, okay?
Latency of the browser and desktop.
Latency of the browser. Anyone else? Distraction. I mean, I was ready to run out of this room and go voting, right? So it could be a bunch of different things. Here, you presented. You don't need a book. You get a book right back there. Someone give him a book. And we had another one right here. Wait, you have Google Glasses. You can afford a book on your own. All right. At any rate, so Again, though, this was a multivariate test, so these were the results individually. But when you combined these two winners, the family image and learn more, what they actually saw was called combination 11, and that was the combination of those two, and that was the multivariate, or the, the recipe or the combination that ended up doing best. And that actually resulted in a 40.6% increase in conversion rates. Okay. Now, if this room would have actually been the hippo, you guys would have missed out on a lot of conversions. Okay. So it says a lot just for allowing data to make the decisions inside of your organization. Okay. Now, what does 40.6% mean? For everyone, it's different. I think we've talked about booking, we'll keep picking on them, but for them, it means a hell of a lot of rooms. And for the campaign, it actually meant a lot of different things. So first was the amount of people that they could talk to and spread their message with. So it was an extra 2.8 million email subscriptions, okay? It was an extra 280,000 volunteers. Now this was a very, very grassroots campaign. Okay, it was really, really interesting how what you'll see here on the next one is that it was the campaign with the most donations between $5 and $20. So every single point mattered. Okay, and actually, this is what it resulted in: an additional $57 million to the campaign. Okay, and actually, it's interesting if all of you really just sat there and thought about your business and thought about that key conversion point and thought about 40% annualized. That increase every month, you had 40% more people signing up for your service, 40% more people that you could talk to, 40% of anything, where would you be? In a lot better place. Yeah?
It looks like that the following steps have equal distribution of the surplus.
Yep. So what we had was email subscriptions were just a raw number of amount of people that signed up. Now, volunteers, about 10% of all people said that they would volunteer. How many people actually, I remember during this, said that I would volunteer. I didn't actually go out and do that. Now, volunteers in this were local organizers. The reason volunteers mattered, though, was volunteers was a group that had a very high propensity towards donating. If I was willing to tell it to someone, yeah, I'm willing to give my time, I was definitely willing to give them $5. So it was a really good indicator. And that's really the significance of it here. So we had 40% more people signing up for emails.
Yeah.
And of that, 10% of people that signed up for emails were volunteers. And then from this cohort of people, they had a $57 million additional donation. So this is a very specific cohort of people. Now this is rounded quite nicely, but this is actual data and results from the campaign. All right, so lesson one, define quantifiable success metrics, okay? Oh, 4 minutes, damn. Lesson two, question everything, okay? So we have a client, Chrome Industries. They sell really cool bags. It's like a hipster thing. They basically said that if people want to connect with our brand, they need to see images. They need to see videos, not just images. That's the core of who we are. Okay, so they challenged the way the site looked. But then the video production team said, man, these videos take forever to produce. They're really, really expensive. So instead of just going out and doing what the brand said that they should do, they slowed down and said, wait, could we test this? So for one of their categories, they decided to create a really nice video and test that against images for that same category and see what was the actual impact on conversions. So they ran the test, images versus videos, and what they saw was an increase in 0.2% conversions. How many people here are in e-commerce? Few. How many people have done video production before? It's pretty expensive and takes a long time, right? Okay, so even for this company, 0.2% of an increase, actually from an operational point of view, didn't make sense at all. So they scrapped all the videos, and now they only have images on their website. Yeah, so I mean, they have quite a bit of traffic. And I agree, like, you want to look at it this way, though. Let's say it was null, right? So it was actually, you could look at 0.2% as pretty much an even test, no results, positive or negative significance. So from that point of view, you definitely don't want to build videos because it didn't do anything. So whether you want to look at it as 0.2 or 0% across the board, what they were able to do with this is make a very much offline decision with online data. And that's the benefit. The offline decision was, should we produce videos? That costs a lot of money. The online decision, or the online data is from their website. Are we good? Booking.com is skeptical. All right. So another client of ours, SimCity, EA Sports. How many people know EA? Okay, it's big. Okay. So they said images are not important, or are important. So they went ahead and they put this New York image on there. And then someone came along and said, nah, images really aren't that important. What's important is getting the call to action higher up on the page. So they went ahead and just simply got rid of the image. They ran a test. And they had a 43.4% increase in conversions. Okay? This is their main channel for distribution of this game. That game, you can see, costs between $59 and $79 per conversion. We're selling video games, so the production of the video game is pretty much a sunk cost, so that's a lot of money right there. Okay? So, lesson two, question everything. Lesson three, relevance matters. Okay? So this is 2%. Does anyone know what 2% represents? Any guesses? I got books. No? Okay. So 2% represents the average, if you looked at all of the e-commerce sites in the world, 2% is about the average conversion rate. Okay, so if you all think about your conversion rates out there, what's interesting about them is that 2% is not actually equal. When you actually look into your 2%, what you might find is that your return visitors are actually pulling up that 2%, converting at 10%. You might see that your new visitors are right in line with the 2%. You might see that your mobile visitors are really not doing well, so we need to think about redoing that. And then up above, those damn Amsterdammers, they're pulling everyone down. They've been hanging out too much. And they're at 0.2%, okay? So what I want to point out here is that that conversion rate that you have has a bunch of information inside of it. And every person, I think both of these data providers were trying to talk about that earlier, was that there's a lot of opportunity with relevance of data to go ahead and improve that. So we'll go back to the Obama campaign and show you guys another quick one. So what they wanted to do on this was they wanted to increase donations on that landing page that we talked about even further, right? So after people gave the email, now we're on the actual donation page, okay? So they ran these buttons against each other. We're gonna have everyone vote again, okay? So what we want to know is how many people thought it was donate now? Few people. Please donate? No one? Why donate? Okay. Donate and get a gift? Okay. And contribute? Okay, so I'm going to say the last three were even. What's really interesting is I don't think anyone in the room got the overarching theme of this lesson. Remember, the lesson was relevance matters, so all of you were wrong, okay? So what actually turned out was that people who had never signed up before, they wanted to get something for free, okay? People that had signed up but for some reason forgot to donate or didn't donate for whatever reason, they really wanted the campaign to beg for their money. Please donate, okay? And then last, the people that had previously donated, they were really just looking for something more transactional, and they wanted to contribute, okay? So that relevance really matters. Another example, this is the Clinton Bush Haiti Fund. I can never get that right. Very, very simple test here. They had submit versus support Haiti. It's the only thing they changed on the entire website. And they had a 15.7% increase in the average donation value. Okay, one simple word on a button. Here's another one. So now we've grown up as a company. We go on both sides of the party aisle. We even helped Romney. He didn't win, but we still helped him. So up above we have the up above here is a general tag. It says, get the latest news and updates from the campaign. Down below, they use geotargeting. This actually says the state, so it says Florida, get the latest news and updates. Okay? From this simple geotargeted test, they got a 19% increase in conversions. Okay? Very, very simple to do. All right, so lesson three, relevance matters. Lesson four, speak their language. So this actually here is a list of the top advertisers in Google AdWords. And from our point of view as a company, this is what a lot of them are doing. They're throwing a lot of money into a black hole. They need guys like you guys to make them spend better on these ads. And what they're doing, you know, actually we found that people spend 9 times more money on driving traffic to their website than they do on converting it. This is a very simple idea here, but just speak their language. So this is something that Optimizely does right now actively, okay? Here is MVT testing. This is something that we compete heavily for. You can see all of our competitors on here. And you can see that we pay a lot of money to be in first position on that. We want you guys to know about Optimizely and click on it. And so what we do is we drive everyone, when they click on that, to this landing page. Does anyone see anything on this landing page that reminds them of what people searched for? In the back? Testing? Yeah, up above, actually, I don't know if you can see it. Now you can. But it says the number one multivariate testing tool. Okay? All we do is change that simple H1 tag to match what they search for in Google. And I bet you right now there's people in this room that manage ad campaigns that have stuff going to things that do not correlate to what they search for in Google. I can promise you right now, you're throwing money out the window because these are the results that we had. Okay? Almost a 40% increase in form fill-outs. I'm not talking about click-through rates or anything. Form fill-outs, that's real intent to connect with our brand. And that's because we change one simple word on the page to match people and call our product what they call it. Okay? So, lesson four, speak their language. Here's just an overview of what we talked about today. If you guys have any questions at all, we have, and you want to ask them in Dutch, we have a full Dutch team. They're here up in front. We will be giving out books as well for questions. And a hippo. Oh, excuse me, I never explained what a hippo was. That's terrible. So a hippo is the highest paid person's opinion. And with data, you can actually challenge that. And you can go ahead and make your organization better by trying to answer questions with those instead of opinions. Okay, so sorry I didn't answer that. The last time chance for the A-B test. If you like what you heard, please participate and come join us at our offices here in just a few weeks, okay? Thank you. Questions?
Goeie vraag betekent een boek, AB-testing.
Hi, I'm in the fashion business. And, in the fashion business.
Fashion, okay.
And one of the main questions we always have is about product photography. So should we show people without a hat or with the hat? Should we use Chinese, whatever people for as a model? So these are serious considerations for the styling department, but we want to test it. But I've asked a lot of people, and I've always had the same answer, that it's pretty much impossible, as you have to test things during within the whole chain. If you show a certain type of photography on the detail page, you should also show it in the recommended products. You should always show it in the basket, etc., etc. How would you do that?
Yeah, I think, actually, we have a client, Zara, and they actually had this question, too. And I was speaking to Luis over there about this. They actually chose, now they have a really big luxury of actually having this stuff in-house, so I don't know your setup, and I don't know that. What they chose to do was actually quite similar to what Chrome did with the videos. They chose a very, very specific line of products, did it for all of that end-to-end, implemented that end-to-end, and then tested that against their other lines. And they, what's really important is that you have consistent, really baseline beforehand, before you go into it. But it is a really tough thing. But if you can do anything to validate before you build or validate before you invest, we believe at Optimizely that's the best way to do testing for questions like that. So think about what would be like the minimum viable product of that idea, test it, and then see if you want to implement it to the rest.
Right. And you still don't have a real A-B test, right? Because you're not testing.
No, well, you do, because what you do is you should have your product, your existing products, right? So let's say I want to sell this shirt. I have my existing image of this shirt, and then I'm going to have the alternate image. So just inside of that category, I'm going to actually be serving both of those to different ones. So you will have it inside of a category. There is a bit of a leap of faith there to try to push it out to the rest, and so the gain would have to be pretty big. What might be interesting, something good, is like trying to crop images before you do, like, you know, different types of people. So one thing that we heard people doing was, do I want to show a full body shot or just the you know, the blouse or the shirt? And that actually was quite interesting. And then they carried that change throughout the entire funnel to see what the impact was. So there's a few ways that you can do it.
Can you use existing testing tools? Because, for example, Website Optimizer, Virtual Website Optimizer doesn't work for this kind of
Well, that's not
things.
True. So what you need to have in that situation, and we can take this offline, but you need to have something at the JavaScript level that queues the actual product ID. So as long as you have unique product IDs and you swap that out, you can key for those and you can swap them dynamically with JavaScript. So you can do it. It will take a little bit of work on your back end, but absolutely, you can do it with Optimizely. You can do it with VWO. You can do it with a lot of things. So, yeah.
A book?
A book, yes, please. We got one in the back there.
So, hi. We're starting to do a lot of testing.
Uh-huh.
So my question is, how do you challenge the hippo who's telling us what the next test should be?
Yeah. Yeah, so that's actually a good question, too. We get that a lot. One of the talks that I also give is about exactly that, how to try to bring that into the company. The first thing that we try to do is allow the hippo to drive the first maybe 5 to 10 tests. Let them realize that no one knows what they're actually talking about. It's all about a wide variety of test ideas. And then once they see, oh, man, I don't win all the time, they get pretty humble pretty quick. And so one thing that you can do at that point is once they bought in, we actually go into companies and we do conversion master classes. Unfortunately, this is not like a service we charge for. It's just something we do ad hoc. But we go in and what we try to do there is we try to get the company to have people all the way from the support frontline up to the hippos. And then we break people into groups and we give them parts of the website. So we say, okay, we want you, this group of a bunch of different people, to look at the product pages. We want you to look at the category pages or the search page or whatever. We let everyone come up with the test ideas. And then at the end, you decide as a team, you should have a central conversion team who actually decides and that aligns with your goals. And then that team goes ahead and runs the test and then the whole company should see the results. And that way you see that it's really the best companies come up with testing ideas from every edge of their organization. If testing is top down, that's not a good thing. It's not a good thing.
In fact, so we should give the hippo something to play with.
Yeah, for sure. I think at the end you give him really amazing reports of all the wins that you're getting and let them say that they brought testing into the organization, for sure.
Okay, cool. That's any key. Questions?
Matt, great presentation. Thank you.
Thanks.
My question is, are you actually collecting patterns? You're helping your clients identify patterns of what types of tests to do, depending on their industry and their specific situation in the industry?
A little bit.
Are you collecting information about that and creating templates, or is it so individual that that doesn't make sense to you?
You can do a little bit of it. I think one of the hardest things with testing is this idea of tribal knowledge and how do you actually take best practices and learnings from your site and spread that throughout an organization. So that's like step one, is building that framework. But from us, from our point of view, we don't do much consulting. We are a technology provider. We partner with a lot of really great agencies and folks like that who are really specialized in doing that. And we'd much rather build a platform on which you can do whatever test you want, and then help those agencies go in and do exactly what you are thinking about.
Thanks.
I'll come back to you guys. She's just making her way.
Hey, Matt, can we still take you up on those 100 beers later?
Yeah, I seriously tried to get the bartenders to bring 100 beers in here, and they said no. So we will have 100 beers from Optimizely after this. But it's only the first 100, so.
Well, thanks for the beer.
Yeah.
But also thanks for the great presentation. Like you said, relevance really matters, and for us, we see that a lot for our customers as well. But do you also help us, we serve a multitude of customers, to identify the people that visit their sites and the relevance, the relevant paths that they have taken to their site? So do you help us identify those people?
Yes, so you can do that in a bunch of different ways. If it's available really at that front-end level, so if you can give us a cookie, if you can set a JavaScript variable on your website, if you can do anything like that, we can key off of that and then change the experience for the user. So for everyone, you can do a really advanced targeting with Optimizely. I mean, from down to things that we have inside of the product up to things that you want to customly build and then pass in through our API. So it's, you know, sky's the limit. But yeah, we see people do some really interesting stuff. Yeah.
Questions?
Yeah, up here. We got more books, so keep them coming. If people are bored, you can go to the bar and put it on our tab.
Before, you said with a fashion example that throughout the process it's important that they see the same message all the time. How do you handle it with customers which use different devices and, for example, we don't have a login?
Yeah.
So how do you make sure that if you test something on your desktop, they get a similar message on mobile, for example?
Yeah, it's tough. Without a login, it's even harder. I would say right now, without a login or some sort of cookie that passes back between people, unless you've come up with something that you can pass to us, I would say with us, we don't. It'd be really hard to key off of anything today. I will say, though, that in general, it depends on how much traffic you have, but I would say in general, if you have these two sets of groups that are, you know, really separated by a different device, I think expectations also change when they come across different devices. What's tough is when you want to offer something across both devices. That's where you need to be sure. I don't have a perfect answer for you today, but we could definitely dig into it with you if you're interested.
Cool, yeah, thanks.
It's a good question.
May I? We saw RTB bidding in begin the first two presentations.
Sorry, say it again?
RTB, the automated bidding bid, the two first presentations.
Yeah, yeah.
They may influence the quality of your traffic. If you bid too low, you get crap quality. If you bid too high, you may find another audience. How does this influence the test you're running with your tool?
Yeah, relevance matters, right? So hopefully if I have a bidding system that is helping me understand who my users are, then that bidding system, I'm guessing you guys do this, is pass me something at that level. So I can say, this is low value, this is high value. I want to show this person Mercedes. I want to show this person the car I drive. I don't, you know, not a Mercedes. So yeah, it should all be based on relevance. And I think at the end of the day, site owners and site optimizers, they know their audience better than we ever could. One thing that we're doing now a lot of is in the US, we're doing it more than Europe because of the different data laws, but people are starting to pipe in third-party data from things like Blue Kai. Has anyone heard of Blue Kai? Okay, so they're basically like, they buy up a bunch of cookies, and then they resell that data to different platforms, and then that you know a more holistic view about that user. And so then we can key off of that as well when people have that integration, and then can give people really specific stuff like mail, age group, whatever you want at that level.
So it's knowing the traffic that you get in to get a relevant result. If you don't know the traffic, it just clicks.
Well, if you don't know the traffic, then you're what you're doing in that situation is you're optimizing for the best average experience. That's not personalization, that's just website optimization, right? So that's day one of optimizing. Over time, you're gonna learn something about your traffic inherently. And you can also key off of things they do within your product or website. So we have a client actually today, we were building something where it's a travel site, and if you have, you can choose children. If you choose 4 children or 3 children, we put them into a big family group, and then going forward, we always know who that is.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
I think it's time for a recap, or do we want more questions? Beer or questions?
There's 2 here. We'll finish these and then we'll go.
Quick questions.
Okay, quick questions. I'll be fast.
So you mentioned a minimum viable product. So I assume you're familiar with Lean Startup and Lean Analytics. One big question that me and my analysts have about Lean Analytics is how to measure virality coefficient. So the number of new signups that originate from an original signup. Do you have any experience with that?
We're doing some really interesting work around this right now. With we're actually doing some machine learning on our own users right now to understand the virality coefficient. In my mind, I don't believe in it. I think it's kind of crap. I think it's one metric that people have applied to every website in the world and doesn't really matter. There's actually a really good talk from the growth team from Facebook, and they talked about how they took the team from, I think it was 30 million to 1 billion users. And actually what they found, it wasn't about the K coefficient. What it was about was actually about getting users in the first 10 days from 0 to 10 friends. And that was it. And once they figured out what that metric was, that's not a K coefficient for them. They started keying in on that, and they knew they could beat anyone at that point. Because it's actually quite easy. And then we talk about these guys. Okay, I'm buying low-value traffic, but I know I need to get them to 10 friends. Well, that's a different path than a high-value, right? So now these high-value people are going to go on this track, and that's a lot of automation, right? So now it's like, okay, you haven't had a friend in 3 days. I'm going to send you an email. So I wouldn't worry so much about the K coefficient as I would about acquisition and behavior on site. And once you have that, you have a recipe to be as big as you want to be, because you know what you can buy traffic at and what you can acquire at. I think that's more valuable.
So I'm wondering what your views are on the sizes needed for data, because a lot of times I get questions from clients that want to use A/B testing, and then they say like, okay, but it's on retargeting, so that's important for us, let's do 10%. Okay, yeah. 10% of a small group is nothing. So how do you work with that?
Yeah, it's tough. You need pretty big sample sizes, especially for things, you know, you guys called me out on the 0.2%. I think that's really legit. Like, you need millions of people to make a difference of point. Yeah, okay, so you need lots of people to make that type of decision. It's a lot of people. So I think if I was growing my website, I'd be looking for general trends and behaviors that support solid hypotheses that I know about my users, more than I would be looking at like rock solid numbers in science. I think there's a transition point when you get into millions of users where you start to make that change. And it's tough for small traffic sites, you know, it's a tough game. But I think in general, think about the behaviors more than the actual statistics at that point.
Nee, jongens, serieus, we gaan aan het bier. Het kan echt te lang
duren. There is a formula.
Ik mag al 6 maanden geen bier drinken. Het is echt best balen. Mike, you want to do a recap? Nee? Okay, guys, beer. Thanks.
I hope someone's...